So in fact, all these molecules, as you said, are L-methionine precursor. So we can wonder, what about their bioefficacy? So we know that there are various trials comparing the effect of DL-methionine and hydroxy-methionine on animal performance that are existing. So we can mention, for example, a trial with Scotus Field Research in 2014 and also with Bark in 2015. And in fact, the conclusion of this is that the full relative bioefficacy of hydroxymethionine compared to DL-methionine is 100%. So really an equivalence in terms of performance. And in fact, I propose for the second part of this webinar to focus on the bioefficacy and the methodology to have this bioefficacy. So Dolores, I will start by you. How can we be sure that the comparison of methionine source is accurate? And what is the methodology that we can use?
Yeah, that's a great question, actually, Florian, because there are plenty of studies over there and people don't really understand what is the right statistical tool to use to compare methionine sources. But first of all, in order to compare this DL-methionine to DL-HMTBA, we usually use a standard basal diet, which is deficient in sulfur amino acid, and then we add gradual doses of each product. Once we done that and we get the performance, we applied exponential models with a common intercept. The intercept here is the performance of the basal diet and a separate plateau. So we have a common intercept, but not a common plateau. And since we know that DL-HMTBA have different sites of absorption, different conversion pathway that Yves just told you about, they don't have the same growth response curve, DLM and DL-HMTBA. Therefore, we cannot use an exponential model with a common plateau to compare them. That's not the right appropriate method to use to compare them. And so once we use an exponential model with separate plateau, we even calculate the bioefficacy or the relative bioefficacy, or what we also call the biological value, by calculating the ratio between the stepneck coefficients of each growth response curve. And we get a confidence interval around this value. And since the confidence interval includes the value 100, we can conclude that DLM and HMTBA are fully equivalent and are 100% bioefficacious in broilers and swine.
And after this theoretical demonstration, can you show us a practical example?
Yes. So what we did at CERN in our R&D department, we performed a trial comparing DL-methionine, DL-HMTBA, and L-methionine, which Yves just told you about, which is the native form of the methionine, on broilers reared from 0 to 42 days old. And we use a standard basal diet based on corn and soybean meal and gradual doses of each product. So once we get the performance of those methionine sources, there is no significant difference between them. And the overall body weight gain was plotted against the total sulfur amino acid intake, just like you can see on the graph. And there is no difference on the growth response curve. Then we applied the exponential model that I was talking about. And you can see on the right part that we get the relative bioefficacy value, and they are around 100%. In addition to that, we get the confidence interval, which also includes the value 100. So based on that, we can conclude that the three methionine sources, DL-methionine, HMTB, and L-methionine, are all three equivalent and are 100% efficacious in animals.
And Dolores, I noticed that you use total sulfur amino acid intake instead of the dose. What is the interest, in fact, to do so?
Yeah, you were right about it. I did use total sulfur amino acid intake, which is calculated using the total feed intake. And the analyzed methionine and cysteine level is in the diet. So we use these criteria to take into account the minor variations that can be observed in feed intake, depending on floor pens, for example, and also the analyze methionine and cysteine levels, knowing that sometimes we can have some minor variation about the incorporation weight. So by doing so, this allows us to strengthen the comparison between the methionine sources and then to come to the conclusion that, yes, we do not have any difference between methionine sources.